from the Gotham Girls Roller Derby in New York City. And you're watching WFTDA.TV. Is that the right address? All right, yeah. Woo! Technology.
Royale with cheese at the Roller Condo. Derby Famous and Notorious deliver in the Royale Ballroom. Notorious anti-stink spray will make your Derby Famous armbands and other gear smell like cookies, babies, kittens, a prostitute's breath, puppies, or moonshine, whichever of those you like most. It's the Notorious R.E.D. Booth, starring Tara Armoff. Hey, Roller Condoers, don't miss the Derby Famous and Notorious R.E.D. fun.
Dang, Mo. I've been seeing the same old boring commercials during the tournaments.
Man, I haven't seen Captain Antic and Boy Reckless forever. I wonder what they've been up to.
I really wish they would bring us something all new.
Captain Antic, I think we've been gone too long.
Boy Reckless, I think it's time for something all new.
I think it's time to get our WAD on.
Good evening, I'm Vince Hannity here with AK 40 Ounce, and you're watching the East Coast Derby Extravaganza from Feasterville, Pennsylvania, brought to you by the Philly Roller Girls and the Women's Flat Track Derby Association.
And we are here on Track 3, bringing you the last WFTDA game of the weekend. On Track 3, we are going to see the Burning River Roller Girls out of Cleveland, Ohio, taking on Connecticut's Stepford Sabotage. Quick look at these two teams. Stepford Sabotage, number 102 in the most recently released rankings. They are 1-7 and were defeated yesterday by Garden State 201-118. And Burning River coming in number 76, 1-5 on the year, and they lost yesterday 195-192 to Green Mountain, a 3-point game, nail biter. And unfortunately, the big loss that they had in that game was Coco Sparks, longtime Burning River Roller Girl.
Indeed. Very interesting to note on the IBRFs, we did see Coco listed on the roster for Burning River. We'll have to keep an eye out to see how that develops, if she will be featured or she'll be played as a jammer. But I will go ahead and start with the Connecticut Roller Girls Stepford Sabotage on the roster for this afternoon. 00 Monkey Brains, 110R Luciana Pulverati, 19 Stick 'Em Up, 1921 Crazy Legs Nikki, 1953 Your Mom, 2006 Lady Trampler, 29 Mama Hotep, 2KO Ether Bunny, number 3 Parker Poison, number 60, the skater formerly known as Pearl Jammer, Katie Brunetti. Number 80, Velocis Slapter. 86D, C. Maya Rage. C4, Black Cherry. And D2E, Inducing Agony.
For the Burning River Roller Girls All-Stars, number 05, Ooh Shiny. Number 11, Decibel. 12 a.m., Midnight Smack. 1337, Furious George. Number 2, Dr. Hoo-Ha. Captain, number 22, West Nell Virus. Number 24, Cup Quake. 360, Dr. Rush. Coco Sparks, as we said, is on the IBRF for this game. She is number 4. Train and Pain, number 79. 8181, Primo Donna. Black Ice, number 906. And last but not certainly not least, Jailbait, number B8. Burning River will be in the blue with the orange and the Stepford Sabotage in their brightest green.
And we're glad to have you along for the ride. And we want to remind you that if you've got questions for us, if you want to tell us your thoughts about how the game's progressing, or you just want to say hello to your favorite announcer, favorite skater, favorite coach, you can reach out to us onto Twitter and to all social media, on Twitter particularly, for the handle WFTDA Live, and use the hashtag talk to WFTDA, and we'll try to answer some of your questions throughout the game broadcast and beyond.
We should have a really interesting game here, Hannity. As we said, both these teams looking to add a victory onto their season. Both lost yesterday, and now one of these teams is going to walk away a winner in at least one of their games this weekend.
Well, there you go at that point. Interesting stat we talked a little bit about before we started the broadcast. Both teams, it's their first appearance this weekend since 2009, since Philly Roller Girls started the lottery system, and we're underway, AK?
Indeed we are. It is Katie Brunetti wearing the Star 4, Stepford Sabotage, and in the blue, it's Cupquake number 24 for Burning River. Cupquake up front being held back by a three wall of Sabotage. Meanwhile, Brunetti looking for room on the outside. Burning River up front, one to beat. Fighting, battling it out with Ooh Shiny is Brunetti. Gets some speed around the outside and picks up lead jammer. Ooh Shiny going for that Hail Mary hit, but has to lay off.
Almost looks like the team's kind of trying to bring the house to a waterfall with a almost a bring the house pick play as opposed to just one skater, bringing in the full four wall, clear out one lane to get through. And for the advantage, it's going to go to Brunetti.
That's right. Finds her way through on the inside, finishes a four-point scoring pass and calls it off just before Cupquake gets back around to score. So our score after one is going to be 4-0 in favor of the Sabotage. Next jam going to be number 19 for Connecticut. That is Stick Up Kid, the new skater for Sabotage. And the jammer for Burning River, number 8181, Primo Donna. They are off. Scrum start. Thick pack, but it is going to be Stepford with the lead jammer. Stick Up Kid gets the L stuck up in the air for her lead jammer.
Two for two for the Stepford Sabotage coming around the outside straightaway. Nice move to the outside.
Yeah, great approach right there. Does it again. Pair of points going up for Stepford. And Burning River's going to sneak in and steal three.
Nice move by Burning River. We were also talking about with some of the stats.
3-3, pardon. So 7-3. Sorry, go ahead, Vince.
Talking about some of the stats earlier. Burning River in particular, their East Coast Derby extravaganza record, including yesterday's game, 1-5. But here's the crazy thing. Of those five losses, combined deficit, 19 points. So they just somehow managed to play everyone close at ECDX, but the largest loss to Connecticut back in 2008.
Revenge game. All right, we've got Ooh Shiny weaving back and forth at the back of the pack with the star for Burning River. Finds her way up through on the inside, and the lead jammer goes to Burning River. First one of them for the bout. Meanwhile, jammer Lady Trampler is a couple strides behind.
Yeah, Connecticut moving to get up front. Connecticut's blocker being sent to the box. Jam gets called, but they will manage to eke out 1 point for Burning River.
Yeah, quick strike from Ooh Shiny. Got in there and called it off quickly because, as we said, just a couple strides behind her was the jammer for Stepford Sabotage. This time for the Sabotage. I have not accustomed myself to looking from this angle. I apologize. Dr. Rush is going to be the jammer for Burning River, and the Stepford Sabotage jammer, moving her way to the outside, is See My Rage at long last. See My Rage getting the jump. Nice movement through the inside, weaves to the out, and picks up a lead jammer.
Yeah, looking like early on, Pax trying to run that multiplayer block pick, just trying to find one lane to get it clean through. Early on, advantage going to Connecticut, but still pretty much a wait and see and feeling each other out process in the first four jams, AK.
See My Rage ends up on her knee pads, but springs back up. Good recycling from Burning River to stay out in front, keeping her held back. One to beat, and Connecticut wisely slowing down the pack, stretching it out, and she is released. It'll be a grand slam for See My Rage.
Trying to hold that bridge for the Stepford Sabotage. Now entering back of the pack for another scoring pass, but nice two wall at the back, holding up. Just as I say, she finds that inside lane.
Meanwhile, for Burning River, we have a star pass. This one early in this game is going to go to the former pivot, Primo Donna. did not see Dr. Rush jam at all yesterday. We did see quite a bit of Primo Donna, who is now wearing the star, right there taking a hit, shrugging it off, taking another hit. Foot race out front. Oh, and she gets taken out of bounds on the straightaway. Great defense right there from Stepford.
And I think the reason why we're seeing a slightly different jammer rotation than we did on Saturday, obviously, the injury to number four, Sparks. Again, she is on the IBRF roster. We haven't fully seen if she's going to take the track, let alone take the track as a jammer. We'll keep you updated as that story progresses.
Meanwhile, the story on the track, another grand slam going to see Maya Rage. Already 15 points on this jam. And Connecticut starting to catch fire right here. She's going to approach the pack slowly, cautiously, gets bumped to the infield right there by Dr. Hoo-Ha, and she will call it off as Primo Donna was making her way back around to the pack. After four jams, our score 29 in favor of Connecticut and 4 for Burning River.
And most of that margin responsible to the 22-point jam by C. Meyer Rage. And we'd like to take a moment to thank some of our sponsors, including Notorious R.E.D., the Notorious R.E.D. penalty box. Notorious Gear Deodorant helps you play dirty but smell clean. Thanks to Notorious R.E.D.
Number 24, Cup Quake, is the jammer for Burning River in this one. And it's going to be Monkey Brains, a recent transfer from Hartford for Connecticut. Monkey Brains scrambling up front, finds some way on the inside, and picks up lead jammer.
Nice job by the Sabotage, controlling the pack towards the back, forcing Burning River blockers into a potential out of play as they'll go ahead and get another lead jam call, but Ether Bunny 2KO being sent to the penalty box.
But a half lap lead for the Connecticut jammer. She gets sent into the score table and calls it off. Monkey Brains attacks but picks up 1 point. Nice effort there. That's going to bring Connecticut to 30. Burning River with 4.
And again, a reminder, if you want to reach us on social media, particularly on the Twitter, just go ahead and use the hashtag Talk2WFTDA. That's Talk, the number 2, WFTDA. We're glad to have you watching. We hope to hear from you.
Black Cherry is the jammer for the Stepford Sabotage, and she's going to be opposed by Black Ice. Black Cherry versus Black Ice, and it will be Black Cherry first. His head fake up front to get past that last Burning River line of defense.
And with jam number 6, that's 5 out of 6 at a bare minimum lead jammer calls for Connecticut early on. Foremost blocker trying to run defense on the Burning River jammer, but she will get called for an out of play.
So now Connecticut in some penalty trouble. It's a 4-2 pack, or 4-1 pack for a second. Now it's back to a 4-2 as the blocker rejoins the pack, and it will get called off.
Yeah, AK, you pointed out earlier, early on we're sitting about, that was jam number 6. With the unofficial rankster stats, we're already looking at about 4-5 penalty trips for Connecticut, but Burning River skating a relatively clean bout. Only one penalty trip, that going to number 11, Decibel. Now the storyline we're keeping an eye on, see how that progresses if it allows Burning River to come back into this bout. But who's that we've got on the jammer line?
We've got Stick Up Kid for Connecticut. And opposite her is Ooh Shiny. Great game yesterday. Burning River against Green Mountain. Did fantastic work on both sides. Right there, still looking for room. Gets pushed to the outside, and that buys time for a lead jammer to be awarded to Stick Up Kid.
But credit to Ooh Shiny, not giving up on the second effort. Coming like Fred and Ginger around turns 3 and 4, and Pack picking up speed.
Jailbreak right now. Pack thickens up, but the jammers will not make it back around before that one is called. So the score will stand 33-4 in favor of the Stepford Sabotage out of Connecticut. New Haven, to be specific. 21-40 left in the first half of gameplay.
And special shout out to Matt Douglas. He's cheering on the Stepford Sabotage before watching the other World Cup with the U.S. taking on Portugal. Glad to have Matt along for the ride with us.
Monkey Brains will be jamming for Connecticut, but lead jammer is going to be Primo Donna, 81-81 for Burning River. Burning up the track. Oh, and it's a power jam. Track cut forced on Monkey Brains, and she will be chilled in the Notorious R.E.D. penalty box.
AK, we were talking earlier about Connecticut losing the penalty battle early on, and now they'll draw the loss as far as who gets the first jammer penalty. Power jam, Burning River might be just what they needed to get right back in this with a 33-4 deficit.
Yeah, some fantastic recycling, though. Nice force out and pull back from Katie Brunetti, a.k.a. Pearl Jammer. And the Sabotage are doing a fine job of slowing down and just killing off this power jam. The Jammer for the Sabotage already standing. We'll have Monkey Brains back in just a second. As Primo Donna has not been able to wildly capitalize on this power jam. Gets taken down to the infield right there and will call it off. Jammer penalty is over. She does pick up 5 points, but they did a good job of mitigating the damage, did the Connecticut Pack Vince.
And that's going to be the first points we'll have for Burning River since about jam number 4, jam number 5. Cutting it to a 24-point deficit with about 20 minutes left in regulation in the first.
And we saw swings and leads about this yesterday in the Burning River game. Again, that one was a 3-pointer, came right down to the end. This one, though, we have Ether Bunny jamming up against Cup Quake. Cup Quake finds room on the outside and picks up lead jammer for Burning River. Meanwhile, Ether Bunny, it's dazed and sent to the outfield, drawn back by, Shiny. Picks up some speed and finds her way through a lackadaisical pack. Now eligible to score, but already in and scoring. It's the jammer for Burning River. Cup Quake taking hits and keeping on rolling. He's going to get 4 points right there and did not call it off before the jammer Ether Bunny got in for Connecticut. So she is going to let her take her 4 points and come back around for another scoring pass. Easy breezy on the inside, got some help from her friends, and picks up 4 points.
And looking to the jammer saying, hey, I'm calling it off. What's going on here at that point? I have a question initially as far as what was going on, why we weren't seeing the 4-0, but I guess the bench said, hey, let's make it an 8-4, put on a few more points and not worry about the nickel and dime. Works out to the advantage. It's now a 20-point game. And update from some Burning River fans through Twitter. Apparently, Coco Sparks was on her way home due to yesterday's injury. So even though she is on the IBRF we've gotten from our officials, we're not going to see her on the track. All our best to Coco. We hope for a full and speedy recovery to her.
I agree wholeheartedly, Vince. Our jammers this time, Black Cherry, number C4 for Connecticut, picking up lead jammer. Meanwhile, number 22, the Captain Wesnell Virus. Ooh, take it down hard right there. Creating a hip check out in front. Diminished defensive core for Connecticut, but they're doing great work with just those two blockers out there.
It's almost like they seem to, I can't quite exactly figure out what's going on. It's like they start at the back, then slowly shift forward, almost going with the flow, staying in front of the jammer at all times, getting in the way. Now, again, starting at the back, letting their jammer through.
And a quick strike right there. Great timing. Heads up jamming from Black Cherry. She will add a couple to their score, and that will bring Connecticut up to 44 points. 17 points for Burning River. The time on the clock is 17:30. Thank you for joining us here from Track 3 of ECDX 2014. Sunday afternoon, getting ready to wrap it up after this one. But, of course, this could have implications. We talked about Burning River coming in just outside of Division 2, number 76. And Connecticut, number 102, they can take this one. They definitely get a lead.
Indeed. Pat keeping it tight on lane one, coming around turns one and two.
See, Maya Rage almost found room, got taken to the outside. Cupquake dancing backwards. And both packs going to come opposite derby direction. See, Maya Rage back in first. Meanwhile, Shiny kind of taking her time to get back in behind the last Stepford blocker.
Yeah, a little surprised on that one, AK. I'm sitting there thinking, hey, hustle. The jam's still going. They still haven't had their jammer break the pack on the initial pass. Get out there, break the clock, start fresh.
See, Maya Rage with lead jammer about ready to attack on a scoring pass. Burning River speeding things up right there, and here comes C. Meyer Rage. Moves to the outside, gets picked off, sent out of bounds, and calls it off.
Yeah, on that last pass, nice shift and strategy by the Stepford Sabotage, going to trap the coat, trap the play, let Burning River go a little bit further out of bounds, while on defense, out of play, puts us to 46-17, advantage Stepford Sabotage.
New jammer this weekend for Burning River, Decibel. If you watched them yesterday, you heard her name quite a few times. She was a dominant force in the pack. Going to hand her the star. She'll be up against Ether Bunny, 2KO for Stepford Sabotage. Ether Bunny scrambling back and forth, but they've got her locked down. Do the Burning River Blockers, playing that hypercube defense, forcing her to the infield. Good job bridging back and dragging her into turn four. Meanwhile, up front, Decibel just fighting, gritting her teeth and getting on those toe stops. She's getting taken down hard right there. Big hit coming across, Vince.
Indeed. Well, interesting with the rotation that we've got with Connecticut is they'll get another lead jammer call, this one going to 2KO Ether Bunny. The most notable name to me on the jammer rotation for Connecticut, of course, number 60, Brunetti, the former Pearl jammer, but we've only seen her with the star once.
An illegal, strange. Okay, we've got a cut track on Decibel, who then handed the panty to the pivot. Wesnell Virus had to take it off. She is not the jammer. Decibel went to the box as the jammer, so that is an invalid pass. Meanwhile, Ether Bunny getting some good speed up, slowed up, but see Connecticut hanging back there. They've got one trapped and got to let her go out of play.
And they'll actually, if I see correctly, that's going to be number 60, Brunetti with the star now.
Beautiful offensive attack out there from Luciana Polverati. Opening things up, they do slow down Ether Bunny just a little bit, but she finishes a four-point scoring pass.
Oh, nice move on the outside by Brunetti to get around Burning River's jammer. Two wall broken up on lane one of turn number four. Gets clear on the second effort. And AK, I was wondering why we weren't seeing more Brunetti, and there we go right there.
That's right, she has the star. Move outside, inside, weaving through that pack in the widest way possible. She went from the outside line to the inside line around those Burning River defenders. And this is a four-point scoring pass. Both jammers speeding back around. Burning River in first, but it'll get called off as West Nile Virus attacks. We'll get 1 point. Connecticut, meanwhile, has crept away and then jumped even further. 65 for the Stepford Sabotage, 18 for Burning River. If you're just joining us, you've missed a great amount of awesome derby this weekend, but we're glad to have you. Burning River is in the blue, and Connecticut is in the green, and we right now are in a Burning River timeout.
And to make sure that we stay in the black, let's thank some of our sponsors, including Rydell Skates. Rydell, the official skate of the WFTDA. Unmatched quality, unmatched performance, it's Rydell. And of course, Adam Wheels, a proud partner and official wheel of the WFTDA. And if you want to be along with Rydell and Adam Wheels talking directly to thousands of Derby fans, hey, advertise on WFTDA.tv. You can contact us via email at sponsorship@WFTDA.com.
And one of the fantastic things about that, Vince, is not only do you have some really big things coming up in the WFTDA, of course, playoffs. We'll know who's going where at the end of this month. But also, if you were wise enough to get in on this action at ECDX 2014, it went international because we've had some phenomenal teams from Europe, Australia, Canada, the fabled Canadas of all places.
It started with Canada back in 2009 and now 2014. I'll tell you who really impressed me that you are fans of. They've been watching pretty much all day, saw previous to this bout, or previous to this game, I should say, Victorian Roller Derby League. I said it before, and I'll say it again. If I am in the D1 playoffs, I do not want to be facing Victoria.
No, monstrous performance this weekend. Big win over Montreal right before this game. So we've got some official discussion going on. The board has it listed as a Burning River timeout, but we have official discussion going on. On top of that, there's going to be a penalty assessed here, an illegal procedure going to Cupquake from Burning River.
And I think what may have happened, AK, we saw this a little bit earlier this afternoon with the 1 p.m. game here on track three. There were some questions about star passes being done out of bounds that turned into an illegal procedure, but those were primarily on the jammer. We've already had the jammer for Burning River in the box. For such, I don't know if this is a further illegal procedure getting assessed on the captain or the pivot. My guess is this is still coming about from that play in the previous jam.
Yeah, she is going in as the pivot, so it would have something to do with that star pass. Meanwhile, lead jammer right now for Connecticut. Coming out strong out of that long timeout. Black Cherry has the finger of power pointed at her. Meanwhile, Burning River's jammer springs free. Nice speed from Ooh Shiny. But Black Cherry is going to get around, pick up four efficiently, and call it off. So another 4-0 jam. Connecticut continues to pull away. Burning River at 18, 69 points up on the board for Connecticut.
And still with Connecticut losing the penalty trip battle, they are still winning on the scoreboard by at least 51 points with just under 13 minutes left in regulation in the first half. I'm still keeping my eye on this to see when or if this is going to start paying off for Burning River as we'll resume action.
Crazy Legs Nikki, first time jamming for number 1921 of Connecticut, and she's going to get out with lead jammer. Going deep in their rotation, and they're still coming out with results. Meanwhile, it is Dr. Rush, her second time with the star, out and in the free and open spaces. Great movement right there. Really heads up, and it wasn't so much that she had to do a lot of movement. It was just dodging the movement of the blockers. Crazy Legs Nikki, patient, and just let them swing and miss.
And the best part, too, coming around turn number four, not only keeping the balance, but leaning the hips forward just enough to get past the hips of the opposing blocker to get that one more point when ending the jam. Great, great move.
Even strength, 5-on-5, our score right now, 73-18 in favor of Connecticut in the green. We start right here, and a lot of action. Dickstrom up front, Connecticut, that last wall, forcing the Burning River jammer into the infield. That is Black Ice, number 906. Still fighting up front, spinning around, not finding any room. Meanwhile, Ooh Shiny is all over See My Rage. It's a one-woman wrecking wall. Black Ice made it out, but it's not lead jammer. Had a no pass, no penalty. So lead jammer goes right there to See My Rage as she breaks out. And we'll call it off, but a little too late because Black Ice was already in the pack. And points will go up. 1, 2, 3 of them for Burning River. That'll bring them up to 21-79 right now for Connecticut.
Not a bad effort by the Stepford Sabotage blocking crew, kind of doing part waterfall, part pick play, trying to clear out that inside lane for the jammer to get through. But as you point out, AK, just a little, too late, as Burning River had already gotten through, gotten the 3 points to make this now a 52-point game.
Cupquake versus Monkey Brains. Two delicious snacks to end your meal. Cupquake sent to the infield, slowed up, and comes back into a two-wall. They're just battling it out right there. That is grit from both of those defenders and that jammer. Meanwhile, out front, lead jammer goes to Monkey Brains.
And look at Monkey Brains with that power, just pushing aside all four blockers for Burning River to get the lead jam call as she comes around the outside straightaway for that scoring pass.
Both teams sending a blocker to the Notorious RED penalty box, and a quick call off right there from Monkey Brains. She was jumping around in the back of that pack, managed to pick up 2 points. 3 points? Yes, indeed. Extra one for the blocker in the box and called it off just in time. That's going to bring us to 76-21.
And while we've got a break in the action, we'd like to say a special thank you to the following WFTDA partners, including Bont, Green Monster, and S1 Helmets. And just a reminder, if you want to talk directly to thousands of Derby fans, advertise on WFTDA.tv. Contact us via email at sponsorship@WFTDA.com.
Ooh, Shiny with some spunk off the jammer line. Great job fighting on the outside. Cuts in, picks up lead jammer. Meanwhile, Lady Trampler, another new jammer coming out for Connecticut. Midnight Smack handed to the penalty box, so it's a 3-2 Connecticut pack out there. Ooh Shiny's going to get in around one down blocker and call it off. Pick up a pair and say no more.
Love Burning River bringing the heat, even with a 3-2 pack disadvantage. Broke up enough of a lane for Ooh Shiny to get on through and get the points and call it off.
Yeah, we're starting to see some fire coming from that Burning River team. Really starting to amp it up. There was no pun intended on that. Un poquito. Pun favor. Back behind the jammer line, we have Katie Brunetti with a few steps to go. Meanwhile, Cupquake locked in a two-wall. She's going to get some help from Primo Donna. Spring her. Gets a little bit of room. Meanwhile, up front, Brunetti is slowed up by West Nell Virus. One-on-one. Brunetti breaks free, gets out, and picks up lead jammer for Connecticut. Wes Snell Virus taking hits and giving them. I'm sorry, that's Cupquake. And breaks free. Decibel locked up in the back, and that frees up an inside lane for Brunetti to get through, jump over, pick up 4 points with a little bit of panache, and call it off.
And for the Ask WFTDA.TV question files, Miss Erica through Twitter asks, hey, where can I find the footage of yesterday's Charlottesville versus Helsinki bout? Well, give us enough post-production time, and you can check it out right here at the archives on WFTDA.TV. But while you're waiting for that post-production time to complete, hey, why not hang out and watch us here on Track 3 with Burning River versus Connecticut?
Archives will start going up on Tuesday, so cool those jets. Not cooling their jets at all. Dr. Rush, the jammer for Burning River, and See My Rage. Well, they're getting cooled down a little bit by those four walls. But, yep, Stepford Sabotage going to pick up lead jammer. Vince, they have been dominant in that category so far. Meanwhile, Dr. Rush has been pulled back around. This could be a grand slam right here. Jammer lap point is picked up, but she goes down at the shoulders of Ooh Shiny.
And Iggy, you were talking earlier as far as the Stepford Sabotage being dominant and getting those lead jammer calls in the first half. And I think part of it, particularly later in the half, we're seeing while they're still holding back the Burning River jammer, they're being smart enough to send at least one blocker in to try and break up the opposing wall and get one lane. And that's all the Stepford Sabotage needs to get clear.
That's right. Jammer coming in right now. Slowed up by, again, Ooh Shiny. It's been everywhere out there. See My Rage still held up. Meanwhile, Burning River has sprung Dr. Rush. She will not get around to score, though. See My Rage will call it off as she returns to the track. And that will bring our score up to 23 for Burning River. And for Connecticut, 88. We have 6.5 minutes left. Thank you for joining us here on Track 3 of ECDX 2014. Again, I am AK 40 Ounce here with Vince Hannity bringing you this action. 4-on-4. Again, we see Stepford out in front. They've got a diamond set up against that blue four wall. Big push coming from Black Cherry. Breaks through and picks up lead jammer. Meanwhile, Burning River's jammer, Primo Donna, sent to the outfield. And again, Stepford stepping up, putting the lockdown on the jammer and allowing a grand slam pass right here. And she will get all five. But she is trailed by a step by Primo Donna.
Looks like for a moment she's going to play some jammer on jammer defense, but buys enough time to hop on through and call it off.
All 4 points. Great job by Black Cherry right there.
Tactical error by Burning River not getting up front. One of the things I think the coach will likely be talking about at the halftime break, and additionally saying, hey, watch that inside lane. Watch that inside lane.
Yeah, you can't leave it open, and they've been doing that. They've done a good job sometimes stealing themselves on the outside, but the inside line a little too easy. All right, right now we've got Katie Brunetti wearing number 60 and the star in the green for Connecticut. Back and forth, lateral blocking as Burning River is adopting a diamond formation right now. Trying to buy some time for their jammer to get out, and she will get out, but she'll get out for the wrong reason. She's going to the box for the blocking out of bounds. So Cupquake will sit, and it's a power jam right now for Connecticut.
In the meantime, Burning River trying to kill the penalty. Reverse bridge to nowhere, going back to the inside straightaway, almost close to the jammer line. Probably the best defense they've run against Brunetti so far this afternoon, AK.
Yeah, they brought her all the way on back right there. She's using her upper body strength to clear out those blockers. Up on her toe stop, speeds through, and finally picks up lead jammer. But standing in the box is quick, and it'll get called off by Brunetti. So Connecticut can start this next one with a power start.
Though I think I'd probably have to go ahead and give credit to Burning River for killing the penalty, killing the power jam for all intents and purposes, even though there's about 10 seconds or less left on it. And if you like that, or you're seeing something else you're liking on this, again, contact us through social media. Just use that hashtag #TalkToWFTDA, talk the number 2 WFTDA. Come on in like a tank and let us know what you're watching.
3:45 left in the first half. It's a power start for Stick Up Kid number 19.
Oh, but it's held up by Burning River in lane 2, lane 3.
and an interesting approach out of the box here for Cupquake. She goes the long way around to pick up some speed. There's a flat wall of... Oh!
Whoa.
Saw that one coming. Yeah, Stepford Sabotage had her locked up with a four wall across the track. And Stick Up Kid came in too hot, came in low, and is going to sit for 30 seconds in the Notorious RD penalty box.
Here's an interesting question, AK.
Sure.
Does Burning River look to try and get an official review and say it as a gross misconduct or leave it as the low block penalty?
You know what? I'd risk it on that one, but that's me personally. Meanwhile, 5 points goes up. They're going to get the advantage here. Cupquake with a grand slam. Burning River hanging back. They're going to jump up. Passive-aggressive offense. Oh, and taken down. Nothing passive about that aggression. She gets hauled to the ground, but draws a penalty. So Stepford Sabotage only with two defenders out there as this power jam continues, Vince.
And I'm watching this foremost blocker for Burning River, number 11, Decibel. We talked about her earlier, just wreaking havoc on that Stepford Sabotage front wall as number 24 gets through for another grand slam.
Yeah, wreaks some havoc herself on the pivot for Connecticut. See, my rage just blasted her over. Right there, Decibel again, locking down the defense. Get some help. But Jammer for the Sabotage will sneak out on the outside, and Stick Up Kid is free. Meanwhile, Cupquake still battling in the pack. Quite a lot of skating in this jam. We're almost done with a full 2 minutes. And she will pick up another grand slam. Big jam right here for Cupquake. Those points will get answered, but not all four. Only 3 points and a good defensive stand right at the end to save that last point. Could pay off in the long run. 104-43 is our score in favor of the Stepford Sabotage. Just over a minute and a half left in this first half.
Coming up on the line, 05. Ooh, shiny for Burning River in the blue. And in the green, your Connecticut Roller Girl Stepford Sabotage. And that's going to be 2006 Lady Trampler.
Ooh, shiny. Just so good at offense, defense, and jamming. Plays some defensive jam. Forces the cut right there. Buys her own power jam. They're going to make it tough on her, though. They don't want her to capitalize. Burning River got some momentum in that last one. And a big sweeping clear out from Burning River. Sends her down, but she springs up and picks up lead jammer.
Yeah, AK, that was just the blocking equivalent of a big, wide, wild right hook to clear out the lane. But it ain't pretty, but it works.
Indeed. Tsunami slide to the inside. Not as successful this time. They try and attack from the back. And Connecticut going to stay out in front. One last attempt, but she peels back, and that allows Ushiny to pick up another grand slam here. Burning River start to come back at the end of the first half. Power jam is over, and Lady Trampler is through on her initial pass. Ushiny one to beat out in front, going face to face, but she was out of play, was the Stepford blocker, so 4 more points will be added for Ushiny.
Burning River blocking crew trying to split the blocking crew for Connecticut. Doesn't work as Stepford Sabotage 2006 Lady Trampler will get through and we'll get 4 on the pass, but not before another 4 by Ushiny and calling it off.
That jam will bring us to halftime. After 30 minutes of gameplay, Burning River Roller Girls 56, Stepford Sabotage of the Connecticut Roller Girls out of New Haven, Connecticut, 108. So we've got a 52-point game, and Burning River picking some momentum up right at the end. Venture, thoughts on the first half?
Well, a little surprised early on because, again, Connecticut's losing the penalty battle. More skaters making trips to the Notorious RED penalty box, making multiple trips there, but you're not seeing it reflected on the scoreboard just yet. We talked about it earlier, a little bit surprised on that low block that Burning River didn't call for an official review to see if perhaps they might get a gross misconduct out of it and an ejection for Connecticut, but that's why I'm an announcer and not a coach. But as you point out, Burning River, I think, finally starting to solve that Connecticut puzzle, coming back in. Again, history shows, even though they haven't been here in about 4 or 5 years, even when they lose, they play it extremely close. And I have a sneaking suspicion this second half is going to be a close one.
Me too. Looking at the penalties, a little bit of a gap there. 15 trips to the box for Stepford and 10 for Burning River. Again, they started out relatively clean and they've stayed relatively clean, at least relative to Stepford. Leading scorers after one, Cupquick with 28. And on the opposite side, Seemeyer Rage picks up 32. That big 22-point jam was what broke it open at the beginning.
Yeah.
And that's really what got Stepford going. All right, folks, we've got just over 10 minutes till the second half, so we'll see you in about 8 minutes. For the final 30 minutes of WFTDA sanctioned action here on Track 3 from East Coast Derby Extravaganza 2014. Again, I'm AK40Ounce here with Vince Hannity, and we'll see you in just a few for the second half of Burning River versus Stepford Sabotage right here on WFTDA.tv.
Welcome back to half number two of Connecticut Roller Girls Stepford Sabotage against the Burning River Roller Girls All-Stars. I am Vince Hannity, joined by AK40Ounce. We're glad to have you along for the ride. AK108-56 Connecticut over Burning River. We talked a little bit during the halftime break about what we've seen and what we expect to see in the second half. How about some of your thoughts? You've done this a time or two.
Yeah, once or twice. And you know what? Burning River came out a little flat. The big jam for Seemeyer Rage of Connecticut opened things up, and then they just started steadily pulling away. But Burning River, towards the second half of the first half, started putting it together, and they started to come back and really strongly came on in those last couple jams of the first half to bring the deficit to what it is right now, 52 points, still in favor of Connecticut, but we've got 30 to play. And Vince, looking back through the scores, we've seen an unusual pattern with Burning River.
What we talked a little bit about earlier, particularly with East Coast Derby Extravaganza, their record they're in. Counting yesterday's game, their combined record is 1-4. But here's the crazy thing. Of those four bouts, combined margin of deficit is 19 points. That's not an average. That's the total. And even more shocking is the biggest loss that they've had was back on June 21st, 2008, 9 points to the Stepford Sabotage. And so I think that's what's throwing us off, seeing what's going on with this 52-point deficit. I don't know if they're still so upset about the injury and the loss to number four, Coco Sparks, if just it's late in the game, late in the day, and everyone's kind of, hey, we're waiting to see Team USA versus Team World. But we did see a little bit of Burning River coming back into it as we went into the halftime break. Now we got to see with that 12-minute break, can they continue the momentum?
They made some good adjustments yesterday against Green Mountain. Brought it back to a three-point game right at the end. There were some technical mistakes on both teams right at the end of that game. It seemed like both teams were trying to give it away. In the end, Green Mountain was victorious. Burning River, though, is a chance for redemption right here. And a much-needed win for both of these teams is at stake. Right now, we have jamming Seemeyer Rage and Cupquick. Seemeyer Rage out first, lead jammer for Sabotage. They're going to send a blocker to the box. That'll make two, so it'll be a 4-2 pack advantage for now three of the pack, Cupquick.
And we're starting to see those numbers add up, if not necessarily for individual skaters, for the entire bench as a whole. I'm still keeping an eye on that, AK. When is going to be the straw that finally breaks the camel's back that is the Stepford Sabotage with his penalty trouble? They're playing with fire at this point.
They are, and they're executing very well, and they're executing at a high level. 4 points on that last one, and that was textbook. They got out, you know, they held back the opposing jammer, got out, scored four, called it off. That's what you want to do in a game that they've got control of, but not total control where they want to go and risk anything. Our score right now, 112-256, and an official timeout right at the beginning of that one. And all of us here at WFTDA.tv would like to take some time to thank our partners.
Well, that'll include Rydell. Rydell Skates, the official skate of the WFTDA. Unmatched quality, unmatched performance. That's Rydell Skates. And particularly Adam Wheels, a proud partner and the official wheel of the WFTDA. Also, a thank you to the Notorious R.E.D., the Notorious R.E.D. penalty box. Notorious gear deodorant. Play dirty, smell clean, thanks to Notorious R.E.D. And if you want to talk directly to thousands of Derby fans, hey, advertise on WFTDA.tv. Contact us via email at sponsorship@WFTDA.com.
Official timeout is done. We've got two jammers waiting for that whistle eagerly. It's Ooh Shiny and Monkey Brains for their respective squads. Connecticut in the green. Monkey Brain's looking for him on the outside. She's got it, but Lee Jammer belongs to Ooh Shiny, who has just been a beast. Said it. She did it yesterday, and she's doing it again. She is running the floor for Burning River.
And we talked about it, particularly in the first half. It was Burning River giving up that inside lane to Connecticut, getting the Connecticut Jammers through on scoring passes and Lee Jammer points. This time around, it's Burning River's Ooh Shiny coming through the inside lane to get that all-important Lee Jammer call.
That's right. She does pick up 2 points, but Monkey Brain snuck in there and took three. They stole one from them without the lead. It's going to bring our score to 114-258. Cupquake with the star for Burning River. Pacing back and forth is Black Cherry. Just wait to see her open it up in spring. She opens it up, but right into the shoulders of those opposing blockers. Swings into the inside, but picked off by Dr. Hoo-Ha, and that buys a lead Jammer for Cupquake.
Yeah, AK, I was just going to say, once again, Burning River about to give up the inside lane, but number two, Dr. Hoo-Ha said, no, you don't, and bought just enough time for their Jammer to come around the outside and get that lead Jammer call. Two in a row, Burning River with one green jersey to beat with See My Rage.
Black Cherry this time taking the outside, got slowed up a little bit, but got out first. 4 points for her. See Cupquake taking a high block there. So that's going to mean 30 seconds in the Notorious RD penalty box.
Yeah, Cupquake going to call it off. Take the 4-4 jam.
And I'm full box over there, Vince.
Yeah, I was going to say, we're at a micro pack with two aside, with number 19 Kit up against number 05, Ooh Shiny.
See Jailbait in the box for Burning River, and for Stafford, it's Crazy Legs Nikki and Katie Brunetti still sitting in the Notorious RD penalty box.
And still being shown as an official timeout. All our officials at center track, not quite sure what they're talking over.
We're talking about the high block. I can see the hand signal out there. Cupquake caught one high. I don't know if they are just confirming that it was a high block, because it was pretty obvious that she held her face afterwards. I don't imagine it was necessarily a negligent, reckless, or malicious, but we'll let them discuss.
Well, strange twist. We were talking about with that one jam, the first jam, how the Stepford Sabotage Jammer came sliding into the back of the pack, got the low block penalty, thought whether or not Burning River might use an official review to challenge whether it was a gross misconduct. Now it looks like our officials are doing it for us in this particular jam, saying, hey, is this reaching the level of gross misconduct rather than 30 seconds for a penalty?
And from a coach's perspective, if I saw the officials out there questioning that at least slightly, I might at that point jump on the opportunity to take that official review, because if there's a question in your mind, their mind, you come out there with some confidence in saying, I thought it was, you might be able to sway them in your direction. Did not see that, though. Just going to let everybody play. It's a 3-2 pack to start this next one out with Ooh Shiny for Burning River up against Black Cherry again.
And Ooh Shiny acting as the blocker in lane one, gets around outside Lee Jammer. Burning River finding all sorts of ways to cover up that mistake in the first half and protect that inside lane.
Black Cherry slowed up by Decibel primarily. She is out, but Ooh Shiny out right behind her. Ooh Shiny already with 4 points. Quick jailbreak. Both teams going to get a blocker back. And a big takedown by Ooh Shiny coming into the pack. And no pack called right there. That's going to be a destruction, but they won't send that last blocker off. And now they will, because they had only one blocker. They're going to get two back right now, but Ooh Shiny comes in a big pileup right there. Takes down Black Cherry. It was her teammate's fault. And 5 points are going up for Ooh Shiny.
And we talked about it earlier. We've been talking about it all game long. Penalties troubling, starting to add up for the Stepford Sabotage. And we're seeing, especially in this jam, with the majority of the jam being a 3-2 Burning River advantage. And 0-5, Ooh Shiny been taking advantage of that all jam long, AK.
Big takedown right there. Black Cherry coming in hard, slamming into Jailbait, taking her down legally. Oh, we've got a track cut right now on Ooh Shiny. So it's a power jam here for Stepford. Good answer back on the little run that Shiny was putting together. And quickly they will tack on 5 points. Grand slam for Black Cherry.
And it was early on with the power jam for the Stepford Sabotage that blew this open for the team from Connecticut. And we'll see if history repeats itself in the second half.
Everybody pushing to the outside. Jail Bait had Black Cherry locked up. The entire Stepford team came to break things open. They do so successfully. And what's inside? It's a 5-point grand slam for Black Cherry. Black Cherry again. Spread out pack, weaving her way, gets slowed up a little bit by Midnight Smack, but finishes a third grand slam pass in a row. They capitalize on the power jam before it ends, and it has ended as Ooh Shiny finishes her scoring pass with three more points for Burning River. A lot of points in that one, and some much needed momentum on the scoreboard for Burning River. 83 points for them, 141 for Connecticut.
Putting it to within 50 points, sitting at about a 48-point margin. And again, if you're out there watching... 58, I stand correct. Math is hard.
It is.
And if you want to help correct my math, if you're out there watching from Cleveland, out there watching from New Haven, or anywhere in the greater Ohio or Connecticut area, hey, go ahead, talk to us. Use Twitter, the hashtag #TalkToWFTDA. We'd love to hear from you.
And loving to hear... That double whistle is Cupquake. She heard it this time. Picks up lead. Jammer for Burning River. Meanwhile, Monkey Brains half track back, quickly making up that space. Great move and hop from Cupquake on the inside. Picks up all four and calls it off just as Monkey Brains gets in with 1 point. Monkey Brains again just keeps on hustling. It seems that she shifts into that extra gear right when the whistles start to blow and always seems to sneak out at least 1 point.
Yeah, particularly with Burning River making the stake, staying at the back of the pack with their jammer on the lead, with the lead jammer call. But that was all hustle by number 24, Cupquake, getting those points. That many times was the blockers helping out the jammer, but with all due respect to Burning River's blocking crew, that was all Cupquake, that last pass.
Yes, it was. We have another official timeout right now. Time on the board is 23 minutes and 39 seconds left in this final WFTDA bout here on Track 3, closing down the WFTD action here at East Coast Derby Extravaganza, brought to us by the Women's Flat Track Derby Association and the Philly Roller Girls. Been hosting this since back in 2007, and they always do a fantastic job. Huge thanks to them for putting this on again. And it is the, if you haven't been here, you need to come next year. It's the can't-miss event. That's not a playoff tournament.
Whether you're skating in a sanctioned bout or a challenge bout or officiating or being a non-skating official or announcing or even volunteering, it is literally a life-changing experience, but a potential game-changing experience. This is actually converting into the official review for Connecticut Roller Girls. We'll see if we can get some updates for the basis of the review and the ultimate result.
And as we are waiting for that, as I said, East Coast Derby Extravaganza brought to us by Philly and the WFTDA. And WFTDA bringing us to you via WFTDA.tv. Stay tuned to WFTDA.tv for the upcoming playoffs. We've got 7 playoff tournaments, 2 Division II tournaments, 4 Division I tournaments, and then ultimately the championship, which will feature both the top 3 teams from each divisional tournament from D1 and some D2 action, D2 championships. A lot of interesting things going on this year, Vince, with the new ranking system, and it's going to be incredible to see how all the action this weekend will impact that, because there were a lot of teams right on the cusp of both Division I and Division II, and I think we've seen some people who are going to jump, like, across on the other side. We've got Terminal City 289, Boston 160.
Mad love to Mac the Mouth, proving that Terminal City is indeed for real. Played it close against Montreal yesterday, and now dominating the Massacre. Tough break for the Massacre this weekend, just running into the buzzsaw, that is Victorian Roller Derby League last night. Wow. And now Terminal City just pouring it on here on track number 2.
Yeah, and Victorian, you want to talk about a buzzsaw right there. They shredded Montreal right before this. I was surprised by the outcome of that game and how dominant the Victorian was, but it's great to see spreading all around the world, you know, a team from Australia coming out. And again, not only is this a great weekend just because there's a lot of different levels of derby, a lot of different teams, we have teams from all over the place, and I can't say it enough how incredible it is to have such a diverse international group here at ECDX every year. They've always been pioneers when it comes to bringing in teams like that.
Well, I remember from a couple of years ago, there was partly the movement to say, hey, let's start bringing in more local teams, which was great because the less distance you have to travel to get to Feasterville, the easier it is for your fans to come, which makes for more engaged bouts, which even if not the most technically or sophisticated bouts are with the most engaged fans are always the most fun. And now, as you point out, AK, going international teams from Canada, teams from Europe, and now teams from Australia.
All right, so the official review is over, and we are back to the action. Katie Brunetti, back and forth, looking for room. She is the chamber for the Stepford Sabotage, wearing the green and white and the star on her helmet and the number 60 on her back. Oh, big takedown on the outside. Chamber for Burning River, thrown to the ground. That was Black Ice. She's going to draw a penalty, but she is still in the back of the pack, and lead jammer has been earned by AKA Pearl Jammer.
Yeah, but Stepford Sabotage sacrificing two blocker trips to the box to get that lead jammer call for Brunetti. She'll call it off for 1 point just in the nick of time to keep Burning River from scoring on that one.
So out of that official review, both teams coming on strong. As you said, 1-0 jam. That brings us to 143-287. And speaking of points, that's what the official review was about. Connecticut came in, questioned the points. The decision, as was originally assessed, the points do stand. They lose their review. They still have all three timeouts for the second half, though.
And Crazy Legs Nikki gets on the inside lane. Lead jammer on a 4-2 pack disadvantage. But again, Connecticut playing with fire. Crazy Legs Nikki going into this, showing on. Okay, a little bit of correction. It was showing for 1 point, 6 trips to the box. Now corrected to 5 trips to the box. But bottom line, AK, simply put, she's in penalty trouble at this point.
Indeed she is. And a great job right there by Cupquick getting out ahead of the jammer for the Sabotage and picking up 1 point on the blocker, returning from the penalty box. Right when she got in, she stepped past her, and that forced a call-off. So 1 point to Connecticut in the last one, and then Burning River in this most recent previous one. 143-289 is our score. Still 54 points. It's about the same deficit we saw at halftime, so neither team has gained any advantage here in the second half. Burning River is going to send Ooh Shiny out to do just that. Meanwhile, Katie Brunetti again being moved back and forth. Or I'm sorry, that's See My Rage this time that they're getting to move laterally over and over again. She gets knocked to the outfield, and here comes Ooh Shiny on a scoring pass.
And great move, sending her back to the pivot line. So getting the jammer lap point for Ooh Shiny. Probably the most effective jammer we've seen this afternoon, this evening for Burning River, as she will clear and the thumb will be out for the Grand Slam.
See My Rage speeding around looking for points. Finds room on the inside. Gets tapped into the infield by Dr. Rush. Meanwhile, busting through. It is Ooh Shiny. 4 point scoring pass. Coming around again.
Stepford Sabotage sending a blocker to try and waterfall up front. Now leaving three in the back to try and trap the goat. Trap the opposing blockers, control the pack, sending Ooh Shiny out of bounds in turn number three and calling it off, but not before getting Burning River to 99 as the Sabotage hold at 147.
That will bring a timeout for Connecticut, their first team timeout. Nope, it is an official review. I saw a ref signal at that bench. But the jam timer out there, hands on the shoulder, so it is an official timeout, not a review. And Burning River over there chatting. Take a look at some numbers real quick. We've got Ooh Shiny with 49 points, leading Burning River, and 1 point ahead of her on the opposite side, Black Cherry with 50. See My Rage right behind her with 40. 28 points from Katie Brunetti, 7 from Monkey Brains, 10 from Stick Up Kid, and then you got 4 points from Crazy Legs, 4 points from Lady Trampler, 4 points for Ether Bunny. They went to a lot of different jammers in the first half, and it paid off because they spread it out. They kept Burning River guessing, and Burning River, as we mentioned, wasn't really able to get their groove until the end of the first half. Meanwhile, on the other side of things, as I said, Ushiny with 49, Cupquake with 38, and 1 point for West Nile Virus, 8 for Primo Donna, and 3 for Black Ice rounds it out. That brings our totals 99 to 147. Vince, got any action on the tweets?
Well, just general, a lot of talk about Boston Terminal City over on Track 2, but we're glad to have you, but certainly not glad as number 24, Cupquake, being sent to the notorious RED penalty box for a track cut penalty.
Three trips to the box for Cupquake, and it's a painful one to go when you've got that helmet panty on with the stars on either side. Lead jammer with the stars on her helmets is Katie Brunetti for Connecticut. Tiptoes in sideways, goes up on her toe stops, gets some extra speed, takes that inside line and picks up a grand slam. Luciana Pulverati taking a seat in the notorious RED penalty box. Meanwhile, Brunetti came in low and fast, and that is a low block. So it's going to be a power jam now for Cupquake, Vince.
And we're going the full 2 minutes. Cupquake dancing around, splits and nails the 360. That's being treated as her initial pass. Scoring will now start on this pass.
See that gallopy style from Cupquake as well as Pearl Jammer, Katie Brunetti. Right there, Cupquake, Boston through, picks up a grand slam as this power jam continues, Vince.
We were talking a little bit with the Charlottesville-Lehigh Valley about as far as techniques with jammers, that it always seems to be a crowd popper and crowd pleaser with jumping the apex, but I think equally, if not more important as a skill for a jammer, is your ability to walk, if not run, on those toe stops, especially trying to avoid those track cut penalties. But low block penalty assessed, blocking out of bounds, didn't see the second arm, second jammer trip in the jam for 24 Cupquake.
So a power jam on top of a power jam here for Katie Brunetti. 5 points going up on that last scoring pass, and here she approaches. Burning River starting to move up right there. Going to hang back, force the no pack, and they must let Brunetti go. She will get all five on that final scoring pass, and that will extend their lead to 162 to 109. Still only 53 points, right about where we were hanging at the end of the first half, and neither team seems to get enough momentum to either pull away or close the gap, Vince.
Well, I think it's actually a little bit more just as Burning River starts to slowly close the gap, Connecticut starts slowly pulling it further back, back, back. And, of course, certainly those two trips to the notorious RED box in the same jam didn't help Cupquake and Burning River at all.
Stick up kid, the jammer for Connecticut, and she will be lead jammer. Quickly out of the box through the pack, and catching up to her is Cupquake. Only two blockers out there for Burning River. They get cleared out. Some great predictive offense from Connecticut. And a call-off right there, 4 points. But the jammer was in for Burning River. Cupquake does tally one. So nice effort from her, and that'll bring our score to 166 to 110. We've got about 17 minutes and 20 seconds left in this second half. Final game here on Track 3, final WFTDA game at least. There will be a little exposition between Team USA and Team Canada after this, and looking forward to seeing that. But right now, we've got a game that is in hand, but not out of hand, and Ushiny seems to be the one that could bring that back.
Yeah, early on it was Connecticut blocker penalties that were letting Burning River get back into it. And now this jam and the previous jam, it is Burning River blocker penalties and particularly jammer penalties that's letting Connecticut and the Stepford Sabotage slowly pull it further back and away.
They're cleaning up here in the second half. Are the Sabotage, would be a call off right there for Black Cherry. Got in with 1 point. 1 point as well. 2 points, pardon me. 1 point as well going up for Burning River. And they get 168 to 111. And like it's not even nickel and diming anymore. It's just pennies.
It's getting to the point where we're at fractions of pennies at this point.
A halfpenny. A half penny? Either way.
2 bits, 1 bit, half a bit?
Well, chomping at the bit to jam our monkey brains and Cupquake. Cupquake looking for some redemption after that double box trip. Meanwhile, Monkey Brains just looking to get back on the track if she's knocked out and dragged back into turn four. Picks up some speed. It's going to scramble past those Burning River blockers. One to beat, and she is out. But Cupquake back around on a scoring pass.
Stepford Sabotage blocking crew being smart to get up front, but Burning River sending some assistance to get Cupquake on through, dancing around outside straightaway, avoids the track cut. Looking like she was going to call off the size to let it go. Wants to try and get maybe one more scoring pass with Burning River up front. Now Connecticut slowly moving up. No, but they're in the back. Gets around and calls it off.
The world's shortest height and distance apex jump right there. She just skipped over there. That line opened wide enough where she could get through, get four, and call it off. And I believe we have set a record for the world's smallest apex jump right there.
That was about a 0.001 on the Jamsterella scale.
Right. Our score, 172 for Stepford Sabotage and 119 for Burning River. Stepford still with a comfortable lead that they had at the half. But Burning River showing a lot of gumption here in the second half. And ooh, shiny. Going to cut hard to the inside to pick up lead jammer. Meanwhile, Stick Up Kid is out. And look at ooh, shiny. Just put distance between her and Stick Up Kid. Good offense from Burning River. Slight pack, but they did a good job of woman-on-woman offense.
Calls it off. And thanks for all your tweets that we're receiving through social media. Again, if you want to talk to us, let us know what you're thinking about, what's going on with the bout, have questions, go ahead and use the hashtag #TalkToWFTDA. Again, talk, the number two, WFTDA. We'd love to hear from you. Now, we had at least one question as far as it related to penalties. We're trying to get some updates. If we get further information, we'll let you know. I know a lot of the penalties we were seeing were, I believe it was low blocks or cut tracks, as relates at least to the jammers.
Yeah, a lot of cut tracks in this game. A lot of forced cut tracks. Right now, lead jammer going to see Maya Rage for Connecticut.
And this is going to be 81-81 Primo Donna taking the star for Burning River.
Yeah, still no luck getting out. See My Rage already picking up a grand slam. 3-3 pack becomes a 3-2 pack, becomes a 4-2 pack in favor of Burning River. But See My Rage weaves her way up to that last defender, and she's held up by Cupquake, who is out in front. Meanwhile, Primo Donna forced to the outfield. The offending blocker is taken down, and she was looking for a penalty right there. She was still getting up and got hit by that jammer coming in.
Oh, she was trying to get up and get those hips behind so she could get that track cut. The officials, I'm sure, had a much better vantage point than we did. No track cut called as far, and I'm quite frankly content to go with that since they were a lot closer than seeing through the netting and the fencing that we've got up here on the mezzanine for track three.
Well, yeah, and it wouldn't have been a track cut anyway. She might have been looking for it, but the blocker who sent her out went down. I think she might have been saying, hey, she hit me when I was still getting up. Either way, no penalty is assessed. Katie Bernetti is the jammer for Connecticut, but lead jammer, ooh, shiny, from Burning River.
Ooh, shiny, about the second top scoring jammer for Burning River. It's been her, and it's been Cupquake, heavy and often in the second half. For the Burning River All-Stars, we've seen skaters like Primo Dalla really pretty much being used in a relief, take a jam off mode at this point, I'd say.
Yep, handful of points up already. Four, ooh, shiny. Bernetti comes into the pack on the scoring pass, gets slowed up a little bit by those two defenders. Now one defender. They're just going to trade blockers in and out of the notorious R&D penalty box. Both teams have a lot of penalty trouble here. We'll address that in just a second, but four points for each jammer coming through on that last scoring pass. Bernetti going to put on the brakes. Ushiny, no such luck. She gets the brakes put on her. Spins around, looks for money outside. Pushes through and picks up a five-pointer.
And I love what the two-all at the back for Burning River was doing. Bernetti had hit the brakes, but they made sure, hey, don't give up that inside lane. Clamp down, and especially when giving up at that point was a 3-2, 4-2 pack disadvantage. Heads up play, and enough for two more points in the pass for both jammers.
So with that call off, our score 136-191. Do the quick math right here. 55-ish points in favor of Connecticut. So about the same differential we saw in the first half. And we expected to see a much more even second half, and it has been that. The score has not evened out, but it hasn't changed much, so it's been a pretty even play.
I would say that's a fair assessment on that one.
Why, thank you. I try and be fair.
There you go.
The Fox News of roller derby announcing, fair and balanced. Meanwhile, Cupquake knocked to the outside by some dirty liberals. Out front, lead jammer belongs to Connecticut. That's Monkey Brains. Cupquake fighting out front. Overcommitting was the defender for Connecticut. And she goes down, allowing Cupquake to get out. Meanwhile, Monkey Brains tries to sneak around the inside. Dr. Hoo-Ha there, along with West Nile Virus. Train and Pain through that little shoulder or booty check on her. And Black Ice out there doing the defensive thing. She will break three, pick up four, and call it off. No points for Burning River. And Vince, let's take a look at these penalties, because we have had a lot here in the second half, and there's some people in trouble.
Yeah, for Burning River, it's Decibel number 11 with sitting with five box trips. West Nile Virus number 22 sitting on six. Cupquake number 24, heavy in the jammer rotation, sitting on four. And for the Stepford Sabotage, most notably 1921 Crazy Legs Nikki with six trips. Katie Brunetti sitting on four. Black Cherry C4 sitting on three. Louisiana Pulverati sitting on four. So the higher numbers in general seem to be a little bit more towards Burning River, although for the total number of skaters, perhaps still with Connecticut. But bottom line, there are a lot of skaters for both teams going to the notorious RED penalty box a lot of times during this game.
Yeah, that's right. As you said, you know, Decibel has five. We have just under 10 minutes left here in the second half of this game. West Nile Virus, the captain, sitting on six. Crazy Lace Nikki with six. Either one of them picks up one more, they foul out. They're done. Decibel pretty close as well. And there's a couple people on the... It would take a handful of penalties. But losing either one of those for these teams would change things here.
And perhaps more noticeable is the actual roles as it breaks up for both teams. The numbers, particularly for Burning River, Decibel still featuring pretty prominently in the lineup, whether a jammer, whether a blocker, whether a pivot. And again, particularly, we were pointing out Cupquake with four. Not really seeing on the Stepford Sabotage and necessarily any huge jammer trouble outside. Brunetti sitting on four. I'm not sure if we're really seeing Brunetti that much in the regular rotations. He's being used to change pace, being used on the occasional star pass.
She will be the jammer in this next one, though. It seems like as we're getting later, she is getting more chances to jam. And that may continue. As I said, we are just under 10 minutes left here in this bout. Slash game. Burning River taking on Connecticut. It'll be a 2-3 pack start in favor of Burning River. And that open space buys Ushiny a lead jammer.
And Ushiny not in foul trouble, only with one box trip and over 50 minutes of action, but gets hung up at the back of the pack.
Ushiny got it. She's seeing stars. Yeah, there's things twinkling around her head right there. She came in and ended up on her knees and just, you see her slowly call it off. Like, wow, she got her bell rung right there.
Yeah, I think that call off was strictly, purely instinctual, just from
survival.
Survival instincts, pretty much.
So we have a 61-point lead right now for Connecticut, 199 to 138. 9 minutes and 7.65 left in this bout. Cupquake jamming for Burning River, but out in front, it's C. Maya Rage picking up lead.
And great job by the Stepford Sabotage, trapping Cupquake to the inside lane, forcing her to come outside, climb the ladder, and Burning River distracted, so C. Maya Rage gets on by for the grand slam on the first pass, and oh, that's going to be a track cut penalty for Cupquake. Box trip number five and power jam, Stepford Sabotage.
Yeah, and it's a 3-2 power jam here. Only two Burning River defenders. Black Ice out there with number 22, West Nile Virus. See, Maya Rage gets around them and will approach. They get Decibel back into the pack. Black Ice gets a booty on her. But See, Maya Rage keeps on rolling, throws a shoulder into that last defender. West Nile Virus breaks three. Another big jam, and, you know, they're capitalizing right here. This is what they need to do, and this is what they didn't got the lead earlier.
Indeed, and they've also got the pack advantage. It was 3-2. Now it's turning into 4-3 advantage. Stepford Sabotage, Notorious R.E.D. penalty box finally emptying out. And
Cupquake passed the star, came back, played defense, got the knockdown on See My Rage. And she's out there with Decibel and Black Ice. Meanwhile, the star has been passed and is now on the helmet of Primo Donna, who finishes the initial pass for the Burning River Jammer position.
I was going to say, AK, I saw a pivot stripe, but I didn't see a Jammer star. I was wondering where it had gone at that point.
Yeah, as soon as she came out of the box, it came off of her helmet right when she stepped on the track, and then she did the little, you know, on the sly, not a reference to on the sly, but on the sly, she snuck it over to Primo Donna, and Primo Donna didn't put it on until she broke free because there are no points to score. It was an initial pass.
Right.
So you want to try and sneak through with it, be all crafty-like.
Doing the, hey man, you cool, pivots, you know, star pass.
Connecticut right now, 223, Burning River, 138, and in these last few jams, we've seen Connecticut take advantage of the power jams, take advantage of the blocker deficit for Burning River, and start to pull away here. We have 7 minutes exactly left on the clock.
Relatively short official timeout. I think just checking over some of the paperwork as it relates to probably the penalties, making sure what's on the scoreboard reflects the jam timer's time. Stepford Sabotage shifting up front, 4-2 pack advantage for the ladies in green.
Katie Bernetti scrambling. She's got energy left. Busting out around the outside, picks up lead jammer for Stepford. Meanwhile, ooh, shiny, held back, gets clearing block, finds room on the outside, and sneaks out as well. Good speed around the outside with some offensive help for Bernetti. 4 points going up for Stepford. And here comes Shiny, but she won't get a chance to get in there. It's called off by Bernetti. And again, they will advance their score further northward. Then Burning River has Burning River with 138, Connecticut with 228. We got a 90-point lead right now for Stepford.
And we have got breaking news on the Talk to WFTDA lead hashtag results there. Mad love to Coco Sparks, who comes in with a thumbs up and a heads high for her teammates for Burning River. Coco, glad to hear from you. Thanks for checking in. Nothing but the best and a full and speedy recovery for you, so we can see you back on the flat track ASAP.
Strongly agree. Double thumbs up right here from this announcer. Meanwhile, Black Cherry picks up lead jammer for Stepford. Burning River going this time to Cupquake, as they have been oft to do in this game. Swing and a miss right there as a call-off comes from Black Cherry. Pair make that 3-4. She did manage to get all 4 points, and that'll bring Connecticut up to 232. Burning River 138. We've got 5:25 left in this bout. If you're just joining us, well, you missed most of it, but we'll bring you the last 5:25 of it. Here from Burning River versus Connecticut. Connecticut in the green, Burning River in the blue. AK 40 ounce. He's Vince Hannity. Vince, who are those jammers?
Well, that's 05. Ooh, Shiny, who's been doing Yeo Woman's work in the jammer rotation for Burning River. She is going to be up against number 60. Number 60, Katie Brunetti. And ooh, Shiny going for the jammer crush. Brunetti says, bye, so long, see ya. We don't want to be here. All right, fine, I'll play your game, you rogue.
Wow, that was the best response ever to the knockout, drag back, the eat the jammer negative pass. She just said, okay, bye, have fun.
Have a nice life, pal.
But look at that, she recovers so quickly, comes out, speeds through that pack.
And we've got no lead jammer, so this is...
No, she finished her negative one pass right here. This will be a lead jammer for Shiny. And you know what? What a way to do something interesting as this game is nearing its close. Bernetti gets knocked to the outfield, still on her initial pass, picks up some speed, gets out and through. She is done and eligible to score, but the Burning River jammer is on a scoring pass. Gets tripped up right there and calls it from her knees.
and Ushiny adds 4 to the Burning River score, make it 232-142. 3:55 remaining, Vince.
Nice to see the code of honor between number 60, Brunetti, and 05, Ushiny, as well reset of the number 86, D, See My Rage, for the Stepford Sabotage, taking on number 24, Cupquake, sitting on 5 penalty box trips, and apparently an update. Both Decibel, number 11, and number 22, West Nell Virus, for Burning River, have fouled out of this evening's game.
Yeah, two big losses right there. They've both been doing a ton of work in the pack. Right now, lead Jammer belongs to Connecticut. Both Jammers out, though. Cupquake just... you got to give her a ton of credit because she has... It's not even a workhorse. She's like the solo horse pulling the cart, doing almost all of the jamming here.
To borrow a phrase from our colleague, Reverend Almighty, Burning River is making her their government mule all day, every day. And as long as we're talking about foul outs...
Yeah, she needs to get overtime pay from this game.
She really does. As long as we're talking about foul outs, it finally happened. Number 7 for 1921, Crazy Legs Nikki. Try saying that 5 times fast. But that's 7 box trips. She's done for the evening. She is now clearing the track. They are putting a blocker in her position to finish out the penalty. And will reset with Ushiny and Brunetti, Burning River and Connecticut, respectively.
Brunetti meeting the 3 wall and drawing a penalty. Great job by those Burning River blockers. Track cut, and it is a power jam as well as lead jam for Ushiny.
And it's going to be a 4-2 pack advantage for Burning River. And Afterburner's hit comes around the outside, not even breaking stride, for the grand slam.
Said it before, say it again. Ushiny is the premier player on this team, both sides of the star. This time gets slowed up by the 3 wall of sabotage, almost sneaks out around the outside, but gets held up. Comeback reset, Lady Trampler out there on her, like a jammer star on Cupquake.
And I loved the 360 move to avoid the directional gameplay and still got the hit to get her to center track, and Cupquake, or excuse me, Ushiny, just in frustration, calls it off. That was all Lady Trampler on that one.
Yeah, huge stand right there for her and Pulverati. And you just see Shiny just got low and threw her shoulder into the stomach. It's just like, anything I got to do to clear this out. So they will gain some points and gain a little bit. Chewing up that difference right there, but it's still 236 for Connecticut and 152 for Burning River. My quick math is right. Ooh, Big Mac. 84 points in favor of Connecticut. So they have tacked on 30 to their lead from halftime.
Well, barring two big jams from Burning River, this will go down if this margin stands as the largest loss that Burning River has ever suffered in any of their East Coast Derby extravaganza games. In the meantime, Cupquake clears on her initial pass.
Almost cut the track, but came in just behind the hips.
And actually almost only counts on horses and hand grenades. Ooh. Jam ref says, guess what? That was a track cut. You're going to the notorious RED penalty box.
No official reviews left for either team, so they can't even question that one. They're just going to let time roll.
Yeah.
We've got 19, 18, 17 left in this game. 236 for Stepford Sabotage and 152 for Burning River.
So, yeah, I think that period clock is going to expire. No! And Burning River still on an ultra jam, giving up to Connecticut. 1 second left. Jam gets off.
And this is an ultimate power jam right here for Brunetti. Full box of Burning River. She has all of her blockers out there. They're going to go passive, sending one up to shake it up. Brunetti will go through, pick up the grand slam. That's the exclamation point on the end. And the Stepford Sabotage from Connecticut Roller Girls, New Haven, Connecticut, have picked up a victory here. It's their first win since at ECDX or ECE or East Coast Derby Extravaganza, whatever you want to call it. Their first win since 2009 when they beat Dominion They lost that weekend to Minnesota, and they lost yesterday, but they picked up the victory here today, and that will bring them to 2-7 in sanctioned play this year. Burning River, on the other hand, will fall to 1-6.
Well, unfortunately, there's always a winner. There's always a loser. Congratulations to the Stepford Sabotage. Even with those number of penalties accumulating throughout the game, they turned the tables on Dominion, forced no less than two foul outs, particularly on Decibel, who's been so crucial to Burning River all weekend long, and especially with the idea of perhaps just kind of their hearts being deflated from Coco Sparks with that injury. And on the way home, again, Coco, thank you so much for checking in. Best wishes for a full and speedy recovery.
Yeah, they're going to get the London Bridge right there. Class X, Connecticut, Stepford Sabotage, our victorious final score, 241 to 152. And as you said, you know, even though with those losses this weekend, right there, heads high. It's on the Twitter, hashtag talk2WFTDA. That, my friends, we'll wrap up the WFTDA sanction play here on Track 3. We do have a big expo game coming up with Team USA versus Team Canada. And as this is the final credits, I suppose, of the WFTDA action over here, I'd like to mention some people who have been working hard all weekend, and I'm going to do my best to do it properly and do it as quickly as possible. The officials for ECDX, the head refs have been John Dilks, Professor Murder, Sam Ruffwell, and Sugar Daddy, head NSO of East Coast Derby Extravaganza, Ejectoral College, and all of our officials, Jerry Riggs, Oliver DePlace, 2D Tin Whistle, High Refinition, DJ Jazzy Ref, Rage Appropriate, Ramblin' Wrecker, Tom O'Hawk, Danger Muffin, Gene Quad, Grand Slam, Dirk Shear, Kel O'Watt, Rule Enforcer, Testosterone, Jeremy, U++, Paul Ref, Veer 3, Kyle Island, Statatui, Lick, Split Lickety, Suki Tawdry, Twin Peaks, David Feckham, Oliver Pisk, Travis Sickle, William Mollis, Organica, Ref Short Fuse, Trippendale, Will Ryder, O Yoshi Dint, Bianca Drunk, Jeff Kristoff, Verbal Assault, Code Adam Strongfimo, Character the Shermanator, Stabby McNeedles, Trogdora the Jaminator, Julius Seizure, Ironmonger, Record Breaker, Influenza, Nowhere to Heidi, Circuit Broad, Carrie Araz, Bruise Almighty, Jason Singer, Helen Bayonne, Direwolf, May the Force, Justin, Matthew Manch, Pirate Booty, Ref in Peace, Chopsaw, Mr. Bill, William Skatespear, Darkness Visible, Drop Dead Gorgon, Gritty Pearl, Admiral Packbar, Deuce Willis, Ted Nuisance, Headless Horseman, Mickey, Emergency, The Axis of Stevel, Geo Knitter, Wishbone Breaker, Bob Lloyd, Heather Harlan, Rhea Culpa, Shebra, Pac-Man, Turtle, Phantasmic, John Lane, Stabby McDude Bro, Z-Dork, Ruth of All Evil, Bros of Stalin, Cleveland, Apron, Umpire Strikes Back, Werner Von Baum, Court Martial, Divine Intervention, Funny Pack, Jean-Philippe Amon, Just Mo, Patricide, Thurston for Justice, Jitter Rocks, Mark McClary, Mistrial, Kelsey Grammer, Biggie Talls, Bacon Ate Her, Aaron Space Museum, Baker Street G, Bushwhack, Lil Butterscotch Cripple, Con Shoke and Curves, Daisy Faye, Brew Cannon, Henchman, Hurricane, Honey Isis, Crisis, Judge Not, No Bueno, Mac the Knife, Magic One, Null Point Ref, Roll On Ya, Skatey, Hitters Club, John Shankum, Jingleheimer Strict, Shorty Doo-Wop, Vanna Down the River, 90 Degree Johnson, Dave Darko, Izzy Normus, Psy Kick, Skate and Nate, Bones, Lil Loca, Aggie Battery, Crash Test Ref, Catechills and Parking Lot, Sam Miracle, Jules and Regulations, Mattis Faction, Tall Glass, Oh, Wada, Betty Mercury, Goblin King, Harry Spotter, Roger Jamjet, and Roll Bar. We are not kidding when we say it takes a village to do this, and all those people deserve a ton of credit. Please raise a glass or give them a round of applause for being the people behind the scenes and in the stripes, doing everything this weekend. A phenomenal job by all of our non-skating officials, bringing us Ringster and keeping things running smoothly here at East Coast Derby Scramaganza 2014. Vince, that was the longest sentence of my life. Please take it home.
Thanks to all our officials, volunteers, non-skating officials, announcers, Blaze Streaming Media, production crew, and a special thanks to the Philly Roller Girls for hosting this every year since 2007, and to the Women's Flat Track Derby Association. Thanks to our announcer brethren and sistren, including Antidote, Amy Jo Moore, Bam Bam, Captain Lou L. Blamo, Crimson Alchemia, Danglebits, DJ TJ, Dr. Shonuff, El Toupet, A Load of Sarcasm, Helen Carnett, Double H, Jake Steele, We Miss You Brother, Kim Deal With It, Max the Axe, Mr. D, Pass the Mic, Plastic Patrick, Professor Lobotomy, Raucous Ron, the Reverend Almighty, Sissy Splasek, Thurston Howell III, Tom Foolery, Wonder Woman, and of course, last but certainly not least, you and me.
That's right. He is Vince Hannity. I have been and will hopefully always be AK 40 Ounce. Thank you for joining us for Burning River versus Connecticut. Final score 241 to 152. And thank you for joining us here from ECDX, East Coast Derby Extravaganza, from the Philly Roller Girls and WFTDA Woof the TV. Thanks to everyone. Coming up, we have a very special presentation of USA versus Canada, a preview of what's to come this fall. Stay tuned.
Want a Royale with cheese at the Rolicon? Derby Famous and Notorious deliver in the Royale Ballroom. Notorious anti-stink spray will make your Derby Famous armbands and other gear smell like cookies, babies, kittens, prostitute's breath, puppies, or moonshine, whichever of those you like most. It's the Notorious R.E.D. Booth, starring Tara Armoff. Hey, Rolicon goers, don't miss the Derby Famous and Notorious R.E.D. fun.
Seen the same old boring commercials during the tournaments.
Man, I haven't seen Captain Antic and Boy Records forever. I wonder what they've been up to.
I really wish they would bring us something all new.
Captain Antic, I think we've been gone too long.
Boy Reckless, I think it's time for something all new.
I think it's time to get our WAD on.
This is how I do all new.
Oh, one. This is how I do all new.
The Dutchland Derby Rollers, and you're watching WFTDA.tv.